कोलेस्ट्रॉल में क्या है?
सर दिस इज वेज इन ऑरेंज ग्रेवी, नॉन वेज इन ऑरेंज ग्रेवी, सम अदर शिट इन ऑरेंज ग्रेवी रिटर्न्स, द रिवेंज ऑफ द ऑरेंज ग्रेवी, लगे रहो ऑरेंज ग्रेवी, राइस एंड मुस्लिम राइस।
डायबिटीज में कुछ है?
सर बजट छाट दिए तो ओनली वैनिला आइसक्रीम।
हेलो,
अरे राघव, लॉन्ग टाइम यार, हाउ आर यू, कैसा यार?
अरे आई एम गुड ब्रो, हाउ आर यू?
I'm good too, and just, you know, trying to figure out life nowadays, really busy with work, you know.
I need to, yeah, and you know what?
What?
I mean, all of this has massively changed since COVID happened.
Okay.
And I mean, I was reading my company's history, and it mentioned that specifically in 2020-21, we had a massive overhaul where 70% of our processes had to go virtual.
Wow, man.
And you know what it means? It means HR and salary cuts. And fully automated customer support.
Oh, I mean, that seems quite interesting. And, you know, while you're mentioning this, I can recall our ISEC days where we were also, you know, trying to manage with the COVID and all, if you remember. But tell me one thing.
Yeah.
Are you able to fully implement your ISEC learnings in the corporate world? I mean, especially when you talk about the customer experience aspect of it.
Honestly, I'm not really sure, because the way we dealt with customer experience back in ISEC was extremely basic to how it functions in real life, especially in my organization.
That's so true. Yeah. And you know, that's quite understandable. And now that you have mentioned this, I think in those days, if we could understand the external perspectives better, it would have contributed holistically in our learning, be it as a TL, as a VP, or as an LCP.
Oh, that's so true. I totally agree with you. It all seems so connected now.
Yeah.
We could have been prepared ourselves for today.
Well, now that you have mentioned...
Hey, my name is Garvit, and in this video, we're going to be talking about how to manage our stakeholders effectively and to ensure that during this COVID pandemic, we're not losing out on any of our customers. So, please stay tuned.
Okay, now before we move any further, I think it is important that we understand the context of what a stakeholder is and what essentially are we talking about, right? A stakeholder is a person who is a contributor in your entity. He or she may be a BD client, could be an OGX EP as well. But at the same time, what is important is that stakeholder is a valuable partner in your entity. Now, what essentially is important that we know the history of our existence and the organization in the first place. ISEC has been here for a long time now, over 30 years. And in that span of time, we've had a lot of EPs, a lot of customers, a lot of stakeholders, and a lot of partners. So at the end of the day, when we are at halt and the entire entity is in a state of turbulence, it is important that we pay attention to those partners who have been contributing in our ISEC journeys over a long time now. Now, it is fairly okay to admit that a lot of our stakeholders or a lot of our partners could be dormant, right? And they could be dormant from a long time now, maybe before the pandemic started. But that doesn't mean that we have to ignore them in some way or the other, or we don't have to pay attention to them just because they're not contributing to our entity, right? It is also important that the new partners that we are trying to establish connections with, we are paying extra attention to them only because those particular partners at this stage may or may not be relevant. But in the future of the entity, they might be a huge contributor and might even become our board of advisors in the long run. So yeah, the context itself is pretty simple. We're talking about how each and every partner is important, and on the bigger hand, how their well-being, their health, and most importantly, the health of a connection that we have with them is important. So yeah, with this video, I think you will get a more detailed idea on how we can establish our relations better with those partners and those clients. So stay tuned.
Problem with us humans is that often at times we tend to try to get those things which are not available. It's closed. And that's what happens when we are actually interacting with our stakeholders. We try to get things that are not possible. What do I do? And the fact is that our economy and the market right now is as deserted as this road.
Wow. Did you guys know that Jeff Bezos actually increased his wealth by almost $24 billion just during the course of this pandemic? And that speaks a lot of the companies that are even functioning, just like Amazon, companies who are in the IT sector, companies who are still flourishing and making full use of the COVID pandemic. Such companies are existing in our country as well. So it is not very fair to say that ISEC market is completely obsolete and our stakeholders are not really available for us. I think it is extremely wrong on our part when we tend to disconnect ourselves from our current partners, saying that we don't have anything to offer to them. We should remember that we are ISECers at the end of the day, and an ISECer always has the power to be solution oriented and to create a way out to serve our customers with whom we have vouched to create a mutual cohesive partnership, right? And that is something that we need to focus on after we understand the importance of our stakeholders and giving them a great Indian experience. One of the few mistakes that we as humans make is firstly, we think that we try to get something out of our partner, or let's just say our stakeholder, which is not entirely possible. You know, I presented that same thought in the video itself, where often at times the opportunity itself is locked and it's not available, but we still try to put our hard work and efforts on it in a manner that we will try to get something that is not even possible. And often at times this leads to us having a very wrong expectation with our stakeholder itself, and which is extremely wrong both on our part and the customer's part. So let's keep the communication clear while we are establishing our roots in the business, right? Secondly, what's fairly important that we understand what do we have to give and what do we have to take, you know, and that forms the context of the entire thing. During the COVID pandemic, a lot of our partnerships that were functioning on a specific give and take actually shook in a huge manner, specifically because our operations and the default subsystems of providing something that we did as in a deal stopped. And for people who had partnered with the companies to provide their interns couldn't provide them. People who were functioning for OGX couldn't do that. People who had events planned, they couldn't ensure that they are happening due to this entire pandemic, right? But that doesn't mean that there is not a second way that we can execute it. There has to be always a second partnership or a second, maybe it could be a compromise on our end or on their end, but the execution part is still possible in some way or the other whenever things are safer, right? So as humans ISECers, we should always have that thought in our mind that there could be and there should be a second way possible, which might not be the best way, but is still a very valid way to execute something. Now, through this entire space, me and Raghav will try to convey our thoughts about the entire stakeholder management to you guys. I've been a BBCX myself, and through my course of experience in the EV term, I'll try to share you guys stories and important aspects of what I feel I did that helped me understand our stakeholder management better. And in the meanwhile, Raghav!
Thanks, Garvit. The only thing we are certain about in these times of crisis is uncertainty itself. The functional and financial impact on our organization has already been mind-boggling, and it is yet not clear how quickly the virus can be brought under control and normal operations be resumed. We, as ISECers, want to exhibit values like that of demonstrating integrity. It is challenging times like these that they are put to practice. Our stakeholders, no matter what age, will be on the lookout for the same. The way we will communicate and engage with them and tell them what it is we are doing to make things right really matters. Whereas imprecise, inconsistent, and delayed communications and engagement will create additional uncertainty and kill trust equally that we have worked on so hard for the last 3 decades. In the month of May, a stakeholders analysis was conducted by ISEC in India to address better the loopholes in the kind of stakeholder engagement and management we do as an entity. So let's find out what our stakeholders had to say. A lot of them, when asked about the engagement that they have with ISEC, gave a 5 out of 10. They reiterated the following reasons. They mentioned how Corona has worsened the various touch points and emphasized on the need for more interaction. They also mentioned how the communication gaps need to be filled for healthier relationships. Also, of how we need to get more involved in our relationship with our stakeholders. They also mentioned that there is a need to evolve our follow-up and feedback mechanisms. And the last but not the least point, that there's a lack of communication with respect to change of points of contact or transitions. Knowing what they want, we need to ask ourselves the following questions. Do we have the capacity in place to understand our reputation's risk exposure if the same things continue to happen? Do we know what our stakeholders think and feel about the situation we are in? Do we know their information requirements? Do we have clear and attainable communication and stakeholder management objectives and outcomes? Are communication roles and responsibilities clear and confirmed within our teams and with the various stakeholders in place? While most of our rating actions since the beginning of the pandemic have been driven by the impact of lockdown on revenue and cash flow, we expect that the stakeholder management will become an important factor in the future. Better embed stakeholder considerations in our decision-making and strategy will limit unintended consequences and help us become more resilient over time. This will play a key role in our transition to recovery and to be able to function better the way that we used to, or even better.
Okay, guys. So specifically, when Raghav has already established that in this current scenario, how crucial it is that we ensure that our stakeholders are still in touch, right? And it is also very important that during this time, we have to ensure that the OGX and the BD stakeholders and the clients that we are in touch with, they are being entertained in the right manner possible. Now, in order to reinstate the same fact, I would like to present some of the most important points that I duly feel that are extremely crucial for any entity or any person in order to have a great stakeholder management, right? So without wasting any time, I'll just quickly move on with the first point, which is about knowing your customer. I think the point itself is quite understood that in order to deliver something in the most effective manner possible, I think it is important that we know our customers well. Now, it is not just about knowing your customer and what are you going to deliver to them, but it is more important that you understand the persona of that customer. Now, even if you are dealing with an OGX EP, even if you're dealing with a prospective lead, even if you're dealing with a particular company entity or an organization that could be a prospective BD raise, it is important that you understand that the purpose behind that person partnering with you. And at the same time, what exactly would they be expecting from you in return? Now, if we take an example of a BD raise, okay, it is important that you understand the persona of that company, the background from where it is coming from, and what do they expect by partnering with you. Now, while you understand this, it will be really helpful for you in the long run when you're creating a partnership that you understand the give and take of it, right? You understand that what more can you provide from your end to that entity and how it can ultimately be better for both of you. And thus, in this manner, in this particular example, you can create a very, a very stable partnership with that particular person. And this will also help you understand the point of contact there, right? The point of contact that you're dealing with, you will be able to understand the persona and the kind of person that you're dealing with. And I think in businesses, it is extremely important that we know the persona of the human in order to have a better set of communication with them, right? So I think knowing our customer at the end of the day is something that is extremely crucial and imperative and is a non-negotiable in the long run. Yeah, moving on to the second point, make me an icicle. Now, what does the statement mean? The statement simply means that while we are delivering a service or while we are ensuring that we are ensuring a good customer experience for an entity, it is important that we ensure that we're delivering a very close ISIC experience to a person. Now, even if we take an example of, let's just say that we are doing an event and we have a person who's not closely related to ISIC, who has not been a part of the entity, but somebody who's volunteering for it. Now, it is very important that as a very first interaction of that person with the entity, it is important that you provide them the most personalized experience than you would do to a member. And it should be extremely close to that same experience, because that person, while he or she will be able to understand the organization better, he or she will be able to propagate it in the outside world. And that is exactly what you need as an entity, right? You need your brand to be in place. You need your entity to penetrate into newer markets, and word of mouth is one of the most effective ways to do it. And while you are actually trying to establish yourself, I think it is imperative for us to engage our stakeholders in a manner that we are providing the same experience that we would to a member, a manager, or an EB, or any person who is associated with this entity or with this organization itself. So yeah, making somebody an ISACA simply means that we are allowing them to enrich, or we are allowing them to be a part of this space, just like we are, and enjoy the kind of atmosphere and environment that we all enjoy. Yeah. Moving on to the third point, I think it is about variety. Yeah, variety is extremely important. Now, how variety is important is in a manner that us Indians, when we take the example of Indians, I think we are extremely critical when it comes to the options that we are given while selecting something. And options is something that we always look out for. Not one, not two, but as many as we can get. And this is something that every Indian or every person who is looking forward to crack a deal would look for other options, better options, more economical options, more structured options, anything at all. Now, if we take an example of maybe a person wants to go for an exchange, and the kind of preferences that he mentioned initially are taking him to specific set of options. Now, if he's not satisfied, he may or may not, you know, show further interest, even though he could have been a prospective conversion. Now, in that aspect, I think it is important for us to be flexible first, but at the same time, we should have a lot of options ready in hand that, okay, if you can adjust in some way or the other, then I can give you this option. If you can adjust in some way or the other, then we have a second option for you. And this is how us as CX team, or us as service providers, we can actually ensure that we are fully loaded with options, but it is the onus of selecting that option is on the client or on the customer. So we have all the options, but what you have to choose is the ball is in your court now for you to choose. And I think variety here plays a key role, that you can trick your customer, not in a bad way, but you can actually convince your customer in a manner that he or she will be attracted towards your product more if you have more opportunities or more variety. So yeah, I think variety is extremely important in all the known aspects. Moving on, the next point is making me a priority. Now, I think something that we all really do appreciate is when we are actually tackling with a service or service provider or a client, that when they make us a priority in the long run. And I think that is extremely important, and it is not necessary that we stay in touch with our client or we stay in touch with our customer, EP, or anyone, just for the short run, till the time we have that deal going, you know, or that partnership going. And once we're done with it, I think it's very unfair that we just, you know, distract ourselves or deviate ourselves or disconnect ourselves from that person or that body. And I think that is not what we look out for. And in order to make lifelong connections, LLCs, I think it is very important that we make our customers our priority. And which is extremely crucial right now, because if you notice the COVID pandemic, we don't have a lot to offer to our customers, and we don't have services running, and we don't have exchanges happening that we can provide them that. So I think the least that we can do is stay connected with them and keep them assured, so that they don't lose faith in the organization. And at the end of the day, we still have stakeholders that will be helpful for us, right? And at the same time, like I mentioned in the previous point, that is not about just understanding the persona of the company, but the persona of the client or the person that you're dealing with. And if you know that person initially, then I think while you are communicating or keeping them engaged, you can still do it in a more efficient manner. If things get better, which I hope that they do, I think you will while you're making your client a priority, it is extremely important that you treat them with urgency also. Yeah. And why is that? Because while you make them a priority, they feel special and they might allow you specific perks or specific incentives that they might not in otherwise, you know, in other cases. So I think making your client or your customer a priority is a very, very fundamental concept that we all should follow. Apart from that, I think it is extremely important that we should keep our customer engaged or keep me engaged, which is again a very, very basic extension to the previous point. This particular point talks about that if you are a customer or if you are, let's just say, a service provider and I am a customer, I would really be looking forward for you from hearing from you, you know. And while the entire COVID pandemic is happening, I will be feeling extremely lost, and I think we all have been in those shoes where we don't have a lot of clarity, and the only thing that I'm looking forward to is hearing something from the entity that I was in touch with before this entire thing happened. Like a lot of our EPs have had already paid for their exchange but couldn't go, and they could possibly ask for refund. And it is on our convincibility power that we keep them engaged and we tell them that, yeah, okay, you don't have to rush into making a very, you know, very, very quick, you know, decision right now, but rather you can just hold on and we can wait for things to get better and things to get safer. That is extremely important and a top-notch priority. And once that happens, I think you can go for an exchange, because I think you wouldn't want to lose out on the opportunity that you have enrolled yourself into. And while we do this, I think it is extremely important that we are not losing out on that customer, and also it is not becoming a financial obligation for the entity in the long run. Yeah. And I think it is that particular example speaks for the fact that it is extremely important for us to keep our customers engaged. At the same time, when you keep somebody engaged, it also speaks for your skills as a salesman. It talks about that how much of your customers can you ultimately, were you able to, you know, your retention of customers, how good was it, and how much of your customers are you able to engage and possibly convert into future EPs, or maybe EPs who actually go for an exchange or get realized at the end of the day. And it speaks for your hard skills as well. So it is not just for the organization, it is something for you. So I think this point holds a lot of importance in the long run. And yeah, let's move on. I think this is the last point, and it is extremely crucial as well, because something that we talk about this a lot, but we often digress from it while we are actually practically implementing all the knowledge and information that we've learned. Wholehearted quality over wholesome quantity. I think the gist of it simply means that while you're giving quality, please ensure that you're giving wholehearted quality instead of giving wholesome quantity. Matlab, if you have a lot of quantity in place, and if you feel that quantity itself will suffice over quality, then I don't think that as a customer I would enjoy it. In the most simple terms, you can make less but make it tasty, rather than making a lot and something that is not edible. You know, and that unedible part would be extremely, you will waste a lot of resources in it. And at the end of the day, if it's not edible, it is of no use, you know. If I have to give an example, let's just say we have an EP who wants to go for an exchange, right? I mean, I'm not specifically confining this topic to just exchange and partnerships, but this could be anything at the end of the day. And if an EP wants to come, let's just say an ICX EP wants to come here for an exchange, and we have a lot of opportunities available, which I have pool of opportunities, like we say, but none of those opportunities are up to the mark. There is something or the other that is missing from it, right? And even though we have a lot of options and it looks very lucrative, it is not at the end of the day a lot, you know, it is not that much ensuring, or maybe something that is still missing that is not actually providing a complete experience, if not on paper, then at least to the EP. So it is extremely important that even if we are giving three opportunities, let's ensure that all three of them are wholehearted quality opportunities, that okay, these three opportunities have the most amount of benefits that you can get while coming to India or while coming to my entity. And we have a lot of support. I think standards are the basic minimum that we are getting, but it is not never about the standards that we are giving, but the journey from realized to complete is only achieved when you deliver something more than those standards. And those are the basic minimums, but it takes a lot more efforts as an host to ensure that your customer is satisfied. And that is where I think this game comes into picture. And while we are in this pandemic, I think it is a great time that we work on our quality as well, and we build those structures with the help of our respective VPs, LCPs, MC, you know, and we build that structure for the long run. So yeah, I think these were the important factors that came into my mind. I think Raghav, you can take it forward.
It's said that the worst of times bring out the best in people. As it happens, this is true for organizations as well. ISEC, like any other global organization, is being challenged by the COVID-19 crisis to find new ways to serve its customers and communities. And we definitely want to rise to the occasion. At International Congress 2020, our PAI elect, Eva, mentioned how 2025 is the direction that in the years to come will make us improve the way that we do ISEC and to enjoy it and appreciate it more. One of the three statements mentioned how by 2025, we build and keep long-term partnerships that enable growth, amplify our impact, and create value for both young people and partners. By delivering on our promises, we make ISEC a first-choice partner for leadership development. The step towards the same will not start next month or next year. It starts now, and not implementing it will have the risks. The risks of misinformation, or overlooking stakeholders' concern or misunderstanding, which could develop into a larger organizational risk. The failure to recognize complex stakeholder issues and give sufficient time and resource to stakeholder engagement. And the last one, stakeholders may develop a lack of confidence in the organization, either as a result of feeling that their concerns and opinions have not been addressed, or that risks are not being adequately managed. The first way forward from our side would be to open yourself to opportunities. Avoid being one of those people who throw up their hands and insist that real relationship just can't be done in the virtual world. Try scheduling coffee meetings with each key stakeholder at a regular time and day each week. Invite them to join you with a favorite morning beverage for a casual check-in to give you a chance to say hello and touch base, much as you would if you ran into each other in the cafeteria. Ask them how their weekend went, find out what's in their mind, share what's ahead for you and the project you're on for this week. Be on the alert to find the small ways that could help you build human connections. The next way forward from our side would be to make their presence felt. Once you discover the communication styles and preferences of each stakeholder, design your interactions accordingly. Make sure that they feel an integral part of the different campaigns, activities, or the decisions that you make. Because at the end of the day, the benefit is both ways in a longer run. We would love for you to encourage small group meetings for deeper discussions. These more intimate conversations have a way of building trust at a faster rate than a larger group calls. Stakeholders may be reluctant to admit having questions, concerns, or issues in a large group meeting. Problem-solving discussions can go far deeper in a small group. These will give you better insights and at the same time make our stakeholders feel important.
And this is how I think we could have done better, you know, by getting that experience, as I said, to our stakeholders.
Yeah, things would have been so much better for even us now.
That's true. That's true, yeah.
Yeah. Chalo, it was nice catching up with you.
Yeah, bro. Let's stay in touch, no? Let's stay in touch with other people also.
डेफिनेटली.
चलो ओके ब्रो, बाय बाय.
India. What comes to your mind when you hear this word? We have often asked this question to a lot of our stakeholders, such as our exchange participants and IRs. And what they respond is, India is a land of diversity. India is full of colors. India has a rich culture. And the most important thing that they talk about is the experience India offers to them. The big fat Indian experience is what we have to offer and what our stakeholders cherish the most. It is to be noted that it is not only limited to our EPs or international friends, but even to our clients and partners with whom we deal on a regular basis. They also enjoy a similar experience. And how can we deliver it? As we saw in the video, it is not only by fulfilling the minimums that we have, but by taking genuine interest in our stakeholders and by going an extra mile to ensure that they have the best experience with us, the one that we promise. That's it from our end. Thank you so much for watching this video. We wish you a great experience by delivering the big fat Indian experience to all your stakeholders.